for one last kiss beneath the kind star's light. I hear you.
Greetings, John McCormack fans in Ireland, from Marston Records in Westchester, Pennsylvania. Hello, I'm Ward Marston, and my partner Scott Kessler and I are so happy to be with you today to celebrate John McCormack's art and the issue of this Marston Records 16 CD set of John McCormack electrical recordings. This set not only includes all of McCormack's electrical recordings from 1925 to 1942, but we have also added as appendices two CDs of McCormack's extant radio broadcast and two CDs of McCormack's earliest recordings from 1904 and 1906, namely the Edison Cylinders, Edison Bell Cylinders, and Gramophone and Typewriter Company recordings. During this short video, I'd like to talk about some of the hurdles that we encountered in producing this set. And I would also like to, of course, play you some of my favorite John McCormack records. There are plenty of those. As a matter of fact, I could spend 2 hours playing you my favorite John McCormack records. But unfortunately, we only have 30 or 35 minutes, so I'll try not to talk too much. As a matter of fact, I'm not going to use a script because it makes me feel more comfortable having no planned agenda. And I feel like I'm more in the room with you when I don't use a script. So if I stumble a little bit, please forgive me, but I like it better this way, and I hope you will too. But before moving into that aspect of the video, I would really like to thank Jeremy Meehan. And I don't quite know how to thank him because he did so much. He has been the spearhead of this entire operation, and without him, there is no possibility that this CD set could have ever been released. Back in 2012, when Jeremy and I first met, he proposed the idea of Marston Records producing a set of McCormack's Odeon recordings. That was a 4-CD set, and we did release it in 2014. No sooner had that set been released, but Jeremy proposed that we do this 16-CD set. I was dubious, to say the least, but Jeremy, the eternal optimist, convinced me that it was possible and that we should move ahead with it. So I got on board and put all my McCormack resources together and started to assemble all of the recordings while Jeremy worked on assembling photos, getting note writers and proofreading and raising money and selling CDs, and on and on and on it went. I can hardly begin to enumerate all the things that Jeremy has done over the past 4 years, and I don't want to embarrass him anyway, so I won't go any further. I'd also like to thank my good friend Doreen McFarlane, who has just produced a marvelous book on John McCormack, which I think you all know about, but I want to make sure you all support her efforts because it really is a fabulous compendium of McCormack's discography, his appearances, a biography, everything you'd ever want to know about John McCormack is in this book, believe me. And Doreen is an amazing person, and she has been enormously helpful to me. Anytime I needed anything, I just phoned her up, and there she was, ready to help me all the time. And Doreen, I'm sorry I can't be there to give you a big hug today, because I sure would like to be. I also would like to thank our note writers, Gordon Ledbetter and Michael Aspinall, who produced extraordinary essays for this 16-CD set, for the booklet that accompanies the 16-CD set. And I want to urge all of you to spend as much time as you can reading this material, because I don't think it's just enough to listen to the records. I think listening to the records and reading this material that we have included is so important to a further understanding of John McCormack and his art. Now, speaking of John McCormack and his art, I think we need to talk a little bit about McCormack and why we're here to celebrate him today. Because Yes, he was a great singer. There were lots of great singers in the 20th century, but there is something that really does set him apart from other great singers. He was a natural communicator, and I don't know how he did it, but when I listen to a McCormack record, I feel like he's in the room with me. There's no doubt about it, and I can't explain it. It's just a feeling that I get, and I have no idea how he managed this. The only other singer who I think approached this sort of a power of communication was Richard Tauber. And the only instrumentalist who I think ever approached it was Fritz Kreisler. And of course, we all know that Kreisler and McCormack were close friends, and they made a number of splendid recordings together. And I should mention that if any of you do not know the recordings that McCormack and Kreisler made together, I urge you to listen to them because they are extraordinary. So now that we have gotten through the preliminaries, let's talk about some of the aspects of the set that I can discuss in a 30-minute video. This set begins with the electrical recordings, and the first 12 CDs present his electrical recordings from 1925 to 1942. Now, what is an electrical recording? An electrical recording utilizes a microphone and electrical amplification. Well, today, that's pretty commonplace, so we don't think much about it. But when this occurred, when electrical recording was first invented in the early 20s, it was a major, major leap forward in terms of technology of recording. It was the most important leap forward that recording had experienced since the inventing of sound recording by Thomas Edison. In 1925, the Victor Company began using the electrical recording method. And it's very interesting because we have a McCormack recording made acoustically and the same song made a year later electrically. And I'd like to play some of that for you right now. We're going to hear Luoghi e Sereni e Cari by Donaudi, recorded in September of 1924 acoustically using the horn method. And then we have the 1925 electrical recording. And the wonderful thing about this is that they are both accompanied by the same pianist, McCormack's lifelong accompanist, Edwin Schneider. So let's first hear a bit of the acoustic recording, and then I will segue into the electrical recording, and I'm sure none of you will have any difficulty hearing the difference. If you were a buyer, if you were a record buyer in 1925, imagine the thrill that you must have experienced to hear electrical recording for the first time. Let's listen.
Trova la pace al mio tradito.
One of the particular advantages of having a video is that you can actually see where I work and how I do what I do. And here I am in my natural habitat, my recording studio. And you can see all my equipment around, hard drive, equalizer, filter, turntable, and so on. And this is where it all happens. And by the way, wasn't that a marvelous recording we just heard from 1925? The first year that Victor did electrical recording, it's amazing how good a job they did, I think at least. And most of this 16 CD set is composed of electrical recordings. The first 12 CDs take us from 1925 to 1942. But at this point, I'd like to talk a little bit about McCormack's earliest recordings, the wax cylinders. And I don't know how many of you know what a cylinder is or have ever seen one or held one. Now, if I were with you, I could pass the cylinder around, but I'll show you. It comes in a box like this, and you take the lid off and you carefully, because they are quite fragile, take the cylinder out. And this is a wax cylinder of John McCormack singing The Dear Little Shamrock. Not one of my favorite McCormack records, and probably not one of your favorites either. And this is an Edison Bell cylinder from November of 1904. Now, it's very difficult to get good copies of McCormack's cylinders. And in some cases, I had to use very poor quality transfers from very bad condition copies of the cylinders. In some cases, I was able to find excellent copies. So I want to give you an idea of what a poor copy of a cylinder sounds like, and then what a good copy sounds like. So I've made a recording of a very bad copy of the Dear Little Shamrock, and I'll play that for you right now.
Dear Little Shamrock, sung by Mr. Joseph McCormack, Edison Bell Records.
That's enough of that. Now, I'm going to get my nice copy of the cylinder, and I'm going to put it onto my electrical cylinder machine. This is a sort of a homemade device that utilizes an electrical phono cartridge and an electric motor that turns the mandrel that holds the cylinder. And I'm going to play you this very nice copy of the cylinder and give you an idea what it sounds like. So now I will stand up and come over here to the machine and very carefully put it on the machine. And I'm going to start the machine going and very carefully put the needle down on it. And with any luck, we will have sound.
The Dear Little Shamrock,
sung by Mr. J.F. McCormack, Edison Bell Records.
Well, that cylinder sounds much better, doesn't it? Now that we've demonstrated that cylinders can actually sound reasonably good, let's talk a little bit about McCormack's voice and how his singing style evolved between 1904 and 1936. I'm going to give you a little comparison of three versions of the same song, The Green Isle of Erin. So we're first going to hear McCormack, a little bit of McCormack's 1904 Edison cylinder of the Green Isle of Erin in F sharp, sung in F sharp. And you will hear that his voice sounds very untrained, that he makes some rather ungainly slides from note to note, something he would never have done later because it's not in very good taste. And also his diction on his earliest recordings is really quite poor. And diction is something that concerned McCormack greatly in his training. And, by 1909, his diction had improved so much, it's almost miraculous. So anyway, let's hear the 1904 cylinder of the Green Isle of Erin.
The Green Isle of Erin, sung by Mr. John McCormack, Edison Records.
I'm going to use next the 1909 Odeon recording that McCormack made of the same song. McCormack actually recorded it in 1906 and in 1909 for Odeon, but I think that using the later Odeon, you really can hear the evolution of McCormack's singing style in much better relief. So this will pick up where we just left off, and this is in G major now. McCormack has decided to transpose the melody up a half tone, and we are now in G major.
I hear it with the tears and the heart while repeating, while far and alone in a strange land I roam, and I weep as I list, and my prayers give it greeting, the voice of the Green Isle, my country.
And now, finally, let's hear his electrical recording from 1936, where he's transposed it back into F sharp again, and you hear McCormack much more emotional in a certain way, but his diction is absolutely impeccable.
Oh, Green Isle of Erin, that waits for me older, though fate may decree, 'tis forever we part. Still exiled and lonely, where'er I may wander, the Green Isle of Erin remains in my green Isle of Erin remains in my heart.
So I think that gives you a good idea of how McCormack's voice evolved over the years and how he really worked awfully hard at the very beginning, and it paid off, obviously paid off. So it comes to the point now where I just would like to play you a few of my favorite McCormack selections in this set. And in the early years of his electric recordings, he recorded a number of popular songs, a couple by Irving Berlin, and this one favorite of mine by Sigmund Romberg. This is "Lover, Come Back to Me."
You went away. I let you. We broke the ties that bind. I wanted to forget you and leave the past behind. Still, the magic of the night I met you seems to stay forever my mind. The sky was blue and high above, the moon was new and so was love. This eager heart of mine was singing, lover, where can you be? Came at last, love had its day. That day is past, you've gone away. This aching heart of mine is singing, lover, come back to me. When I remember every little thing you used to do, I'm so lonely. Every road I walk along, I've walked along with you. No wonder I am lonely. The sky is blue, the night is cold, the but love is old, and while I'm waiting, this heart of mine is singing, lover, come back.
Now I'd like to play you two English songs. They might be considered art songs. And this sort of material is where McCormack really shines as a communicator. We're first going to hear "Now Sleeps the Crimson Petal" by Roger Quilter, followed directly by "Birdsongs at Eventide" by Eric Coates.
In the palace wharf, nor winks the gold fin in the porphyry font, the firefly wakens, waken thou with me. in me.
Oh my goodness, those two songs are so marvelous. They're among my absolute favorite McCormack records of all he recorded. And I should mention that the accompanying by Edwin Schneider is absolutely perfect for McCormack, and it's no wonder that McCormack loved his playing so much. Well, now we're going to turn to something quite classical, and this is a recording of the aria from Christ on the Mount of Olives by Beethoven. And the English words for this aria begins with the line, "My heart is sore within me." McCormack recorded the recitative and the aria in English, and he also recorded the recitative in German in the original language. Why he didn't record the aria in German is completely unknown. Perhaps the Victor Company decided it wasn't worth it. Who knows? In any case, none of the recordings were published, but I own McCormack's original copies of the test pressings, so I'm going to just play the aria because it is 4 minutes long and we have the constraints of time to deal with. So let's hear now, "My Heart is Sore Within Me," from Christ on the Mount of Olives, recorded by John McCormack in 1930.
Thank you.
terror sees me, and in darkness I am dwelling night and day. Like a shadow that declineth o'er my days with constant fear. I am weary with my groaning, and my eyes are dimmed with tears, and my eyes dimmed with tears. Father, Lord, in a pain and sorrow, unbounded, Lord, Lord, arise for me, Lord, arise for me. For my heart is sore within me, and my spirit faints away, and my spirit faints away. I am weary with my groaning. I am weary with my groaning, and my eyes are dim. And my eyes dimmed with tears. Father, Lord, in a pain and sorrow, Lord, I serve and pray. For thy power, for thy power is unbounded. Lord, arise, deliver me. Lord, arise, deliver me.
Isn't that a marvelous performance? McCormack's in wonderful vocal shape, and I can't imagine why Victor didn't issue it. It's just impossible to know the answer to that question. However, we are so fortunate to have the test pressings that belong to McCormack, and so many test pressings that we have that are now part of this 16 CD set. I am greatly indebted to the late Dave Fitzgerald for lending me a huge collection of test pressings that he owned, and also collectors in this country, John Bolig and Larry Holdridge, for making their collection of test pressings available to me as well. Well, let's move on. Let's move to some Irish traditional songs that McCormack loved to sing in his concerts. And we're first going to hear a recording he made in 1928 of By the Shortcut to the Rosses. And actually, this is an unpublished take. This is take one that was not issued at the time. But again, we have a test pressing of it. So here we go, By the Shortcut to the Rosses.
By the shortcut to the Rosses, a fairy girl I met. I was taken by her beauty as a fish is in a net. The fern uncurled to look at her, so very fair was she, with her hair as bright as the seaweed that floats in from the sea. By the shortcut to the Rosses, 'twas on the 1st of May, I heard the fairies piping, and they piped me heart away. They piped till I was mad with joy, but when I was alone, I found me heart was piped away, and in me breast a stone. By the shortcut to the Rosses, 'tis I'll go nevermore, lest she should also steal me soul, who stole me heart before. Lest she take me soul and crush it like a dead leaf in her hand, for the shortcut to the Rosses is the road to fairyland.
The second of the traditional songs that I have chosen is one that McCormack never recorded commercially, but he did sing it on two radio broadcasts that we have. Now, as I mentioned to you earlier, two of the CDs in this set are devoted to McCormack radio broadcasts. And so I thought it would be appropriate that I play something from one of these broadcasts. And it's wonderful to hear McCormack introduce his own number. And it's something that really gives you a flavor of his personality. And I really enjoy these broadcasts. And so I, of course, hope you do as well. The song is The Auld Turf Fire. And it comes from a January 2nd, 1937 seal test broadcast, where McCormack was the MC of the entire hour. And he introduces this number as follows.
A long time ago, when I first came to London, I had a great old admirer, a dyed-in-the-wool Fenian, who was always asking me to sing The Auld Turf Fire. It was useless to tell him that I didn't know it. Sure, John, he'd say, everybody in Ireland knows The Auld Turf Fire. And he'd hum it to me, but alas, he was no Caruso. And although I learned the words, I never quite could quick pick up that melody. And imagine my surprise when this summer, Herbert Hughes wired me that he'd found the tune. How I'd like to sing it for that old Fenian. It's a croon in the real sense of the term. My dear friend Teddy Schneider, whom I'm sorry to say could not be with me tonight, as he has a very bad cold. And this is the first time in the 12 years that I've been broadcasting that Teddy is not at the piano. But a good friend of his and mine will accompany me. And in order to appreciate this song, I wish you would just visualize an old man sitting by the fireside and singing it more or less like this.
Oh, the owl turf fire and the hearth swept clean. There is no one half so happy as meself and Paddy Keane. With the baby in the cradle, you can hear her mammy say, wouldn't you go to sleep, Alana, till I wet your daddy's tay? Oh, the man that I work for is a richer man than me, but somehow in this world, faith, we never can agree. He has big towering mansions and castles over all, but sure I wouldn't exchange with him me little marble hall. I have got a little house and a tidy bit of land. You'd never see a better on the side of Knockna Grand. I've no piano in the corner and no pictures on the wall,
But I'm somehow quite contented in me little marble hall. Oh, the old turf fire and the hearth swept clean. There is no one half so happy as myself and Paddy Keen. With the baby in the cradle, you can hear her mammy say, wouldn't you go to sleep, Alana, till I wet your daddy's tail?
Next, I'd like to play one of McCormack's last recordings, dating from 1941. It's another traditional song called Bantry Bay, which I'm sure you all know. You know, over the years, record collectors have often disparaged McCormack's later recordings because he certainly was in vocal decline, and certain recording sessions saw him having vocal difficulties. Sometimes he sounds tired. Sometimes he has a difficult time in negotiating high notes. But there's always that power to communicate that no matter what the vocal, no matter what the vocalizing sounds like, there's always this amazing ability to communicate. And certainly we hear it here in Bantry Bay. And actually, during this recording session, his voice sounds quite good, I think. What do you think?
As I'm sitting all alone in the gloaming, it might have been but yesterday that we watched the fisher sails all homing till the little herring fleet at anchor lay. Then the fisher girls with baskets swinging came running down the old stone way. Every lassie to her sailor lad was welcome back to Bantry Bay. Then we heard the piper's sweet note tuning, and all the lassies turned to hear as they mingled with a soft voice crooning, till the music floated down the wooden pier. Save ye kindly, colleens all, said the piper, hands across and trippet while I play. And a tender sound of song and merry dancing stole softly. I'm sitting all alone in the gloaming, the shadows of the past draw near, and I see the loving faces round me that used to glad the old brown . Some are gone upon their last loved homing, some are left, but they are old and gray, and we're waiting for the tide in the gloaming to sail upon the great highway to the land of rest unending, all peacefully from Bantry Bay.
Well, it's just about time to say goodbye. But before I play the last selection of the day, I'd like to thank you all again for helping to support this project. We couldn't have done it without every one of you. And it really makes me so happy that I've been able to produce this wonderful McCormack edition. I'd also like to thank my assistant and videographer, Mark Stehle, for his invaluable help in producing this video, for I know nothing about videos. You know, everybody produces their own videos these days on YouTube and everywhere else, but I am completely clueless. So I'm hoping that you've enjoyed this, and I couldn't have done it without Mark's help. Now to our final selection. It's been a difficult choice to make because McCormack made so many wonderful records. But this record is one that I wasn't actually familiar with until about 4 years ago. I owned the record most of my life, but I never played it. It was brought to my attention by Doreen McFarlane's husband, Michael, who sadly is no longer with us. But we enjoyed a lovely visit together here at Scott's and my house in Westchester, Pennsylvania, back in 2014. And before the McFarlanes left the house, Michael asked me if I would play one more McCormack record for him. And of course I said yes. And he asked me to play Charm Me Asleep by Sanderson, which I had never heard. I put the record on the turntable and I was charmed. It's a wonderful record and a great closer, and I'd like to dedicate it to the memory of Michael McFarlane. Charm Me Asleep.
Baptize all the flowers.